So antigen tests can have false positives. Say 1% or 2% of all of the tests that are used might actually falsely turn positive. This is a problem with lots of tests like this that detect antigens. And it's a problem that we contend with all the time, and we have good solutions for. There's a very simple solution, for example, and that is that for every package of 30 paper strip tests that you get an additional 5 tests that look the same, feel the same, but they actually have a different molecular chemistry, and so they look for a different part of the virus. So this one might be looking for nucleocapsid protein, and this one would be looking for the spike protein. One looks for the elbows of a person, and one is more specific and looks for the eyes of a person. So these would be looking for different features of the virus. And if so that would really cut down. If you have a 1 in 100 or a 2 in 100 chance of it being false positive on the first test, and then you also require to confirm that positive with the second test, you can get specificity so that your false positive rate is maybe, say, 1 in 1,000. And that's a very reasonable number. So what it could also do, though, a lot of people I hear say, well, it's just too many. If you were testing 20 million people in the US with a 1% false positive rate, that's too many PCRs. I want to really clarify this. It sounds like a lot, but we have now developed a huge infrastructure for PCR-based testing in this country. And this is like the gold standard confirmation. So even if we didn't have the dual testing right at home, and you had a 1% of positives had to actually send a specimen in to get confirmed in a laboratory, right now we have about 900,000 PCR tests that we can do every day in the United States. If we can offload all of the surveillance testing we're currently doing with PCR testing and use these potentially more efficient rapid tests, we're not doing 900,000 surveillance tests, we're doing 20 million surveillance tests. And if you have a 1% false positive rate, then that means you have about 200,000 additional tests that you have to test via PCR each day. So we have now built up a capacity to do 900,000 PCR tests a day. We would shift most of that to the rapid antigen tests. And then we would, worst case scenarios, then we continue doing 200,000 instead of 900,000 in the labs, which would get those results back to people very quickly. So I think that even if we don't get the specificity through a dual kind of rapid test up to 1 in 1,000 false positives, if it's still 1 in 100, that's not an insurmountable number of additional tests to do. And in return, we're not just doing 900,000 COVID tests a day, we're doing 20 million. And this is really a huge benefit overall. So I don't actually see the false positive either way. I think there's easy solutions with the dual testing, but even if we have to confirm all of them with PCR, I don't see that as a major issue relative to what we're doing now, which frankly is trying to test everyone in a surveillance program through PCR.